Professor Ian Yeoman, the first crystal ball gazer in tourism, as he calls himself, and connected to the European Tourism Futures Institute, is usually addressing three main drivers affecting the future of tourism: the distribution of wealth, the development of technology, and the scarcity of resources. In his previous lecture, he addressed the future tourist, and he mainly connected that to the distribution of wealth. The lecture of today, however, is about scarcity of resources, and he addresses the subject of scarcity of food.
Yeah, that's an interesting driver for change. We all know that consumption of meat by the upcoming middle classes in China and India will affect food prices, also for ourselves. We already see at the moment how the production of biofuel has driven up oil food prices in third world countries. And you have to think also of the effect that megacities like Seoul in the future, in the middle of the 21st century, may end up having 100 million inhabitants. What effect that will have not only on the amount of food that we need, but also on food logistics. So all this will have a change on the meaning that food will have for us.
And this meaning probably also has effect on the role of the man in the household. Ian speaks about the rise of the gastrosexual, and a new surprisingly concept to me.
Yes, of course, if food becomes scarce, it also becomes special. And as Ian says, processing food, baking and cooking, is the last craft we have as men to express ourselves. Formerly, we had many more crafts to show off how good we are. And in the future, the last craft we will have for that objective is cooking, is being in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Well, another subject that Ian will address in his lecture is the future of hotels.
Yeah. There he speaks mainly about the other driver for change, which is technology. And we see that in two elements. In the first place, technology and sustainability also will have an impact on the operations in hotels. So we'll smoothen or we'll change operations in hotels, we'll create more intelligent operations. And on the other hand, we have to see critically if this is valid for all hotels, but he also considers technology as a factor that will enhance the experience of hotel guests.
Mm-hmm. Well, this conversation has made me really interested in learning more about the drivers of tourism. Let's go for his lecture.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you, Albert. It's quite a big topic, everything else. I'm going to talk, it's not about everything else, it's about nearly everything else. So that's the boundaries of the talk. So I'm going to miss a few things out, okay? So I'm going to typically focus on some trends in society relating to food and some trends in society relating to hotels and what their purpose is. So that was somebody trying to get in? Just let them in. We're not that cruel. Hello. We said the last one in buys all the beers on the way out. Is that right? Is that okay? So if you take the orders now, we'll be okay. So, okay, let's just start. Technology, my favorite subject. Just want to talk, food's changed. You know, food's very mainstream in life today. It's, you know, when I was a child and we used to wake up on a Saturday morning, we always used to watch the TV. And it was always on BBC One in the UK, it was always children's TV. But today, it's not. Children's TV's been moved out of BBC One on a Saturday morning and it's been replaced by cookery programs. And at the same time, the other mainstream channel, ITV, it's cookery programs today. So the world has exploded in the terms of our interest in food. And that's represented by that sign. If you look at the best-selling list in terms of books, 7 of the 20 top-selling books on the Amazon website relate to cookery or baking. The best-selling book this Christmas on Amazon is Jamie Oliver's book, that one. So it's just a representation in society and how we interest it. It's also a representation in the terms of the extension of the experience economy. of what it's all about, experiences and doing things. And it's also a representation in society, the importance of the home and how home becomes an entertainment system. And food's also important in how we do and what we do. So foods change society. It's very important. Today, we have celebrity chefs. You know, they've proliferated. They're absolutely everywhere. So there's something about food in society in the terms of culture and its role in society that's important. So I'm going to explore that concept in the terms of food. And the other thing I'm going to talk about in the terms of food is about men and why food's important to men. And it's about the role of the chef in society and why the role of the chef in society is more important. So let's talk about a couple of things. Let's talk about why is food in society? What do Europeans talk about So if you give a consumers a list of things that you do, you say to consumers, what are you talking about? Take the Dutch consumer. The number one thing that Dutch consumers always talk about is holidays. But the second one's food and the third one's books. So those three things that we're talking about, and this is how we talk to other people, are a representation of the experience economy and how society's changed. The role of books in society, the role of food in society, and the role of holidays in society. And they're all interrelated. Food today and food tourism is a core driver and a core experience within the holiday mix in the terms of the niches that we've got. So it's important. So it's an identification of the trend, what we call either cultural capital or social capital. What we mean by cultural capital, how do you distinguish yourselves from other consumers? And we distinguish ourselves from other consumers about not how much material wealth that we've got, it's what we've done or where we've been in the terms of experiences. One of the things that's very important to that is the role of food in society. And food is very important. This is a correlation graph. We often talk about peak oil and the price of oil. But the other thing to think about is the price of food as a very basic commodity. And if you look at some of the indexes from the FAO, the UN Agency for Food and Agricultural Organization, it talks about the price of food. Because today, I can't remember how many people are living in the planet, it's about 6.8 billion people on this planet. By the year 2050, it's about 10 billion people on the planet. So all of these people on the planet are going to eat more food, but there's only a certain amount of space that you've got. So the trend is, in the terms of food, as oil becomes scarcer, also food becomes scarcer. You know, food prices rise. Okay, food prices rise. So it's a direct, we talk about peak oil, but you need to talk about the price of food as well. And fundamentally, what's driving that is about Asian consumers. If you go into the future, as that Asian consumer becomes richer, their diet's changing. They're starting to eat more products that are Western bases because they're starting to eat more wheat. They're starting to eat more meat. So moving from a rice-based economy, which is still fundamental to what they're doing, but diversification in the terms of other products. So there's going to be more people on the planet and greater demand for food and the types of diet that they've got. So how can you represent this in the future? Well, if you're a futurist, we've been talking about food and its representation since the beginning of time. Has anybody seen this film called Soylent Green or heard of it, which was Edward G. Robinson's last film? Many of you won't know who Edward G. Robinson is. You know who Edward G. Robinson is? Nobody? Great actor. One of the best gangster films. Well, this was a film from the 1970s. In the 1970s, there was a whole realm of science fiction film which represented the contemporary issues of the day. And this is the trailer for the film.
What is the secret of Soylent Green?
New York City, in the year 2022. Nothing runs anymore. Nothing works. But the people are the same. And the people will do anything to get what they need.
This is the police!
What they need most is Soylent Green.
The supply of Soylent Green has been exhausted. Return to your home!
Detective Sergeant Thorne. He has a 2-year backlog of unsolved murders. Now he's on a case that must be solved. Saul Roth, Thorne's private library.
Hey, Saul!
A living book in a world without books.
Have some pencils, courtesy of your next assignment. William R. Simonson.
Simonson. He was the first to learn the secret of Soylent Green.
They told me to say that they were sorry, but that you had become unreliable.
Saul Roth was the next to know.
How did we come to this?
And he chose to die rather than reveal the secret of Soylent Green.
What is the secret of Soylent Green?
Why did you set up Simonson?
I didn't.
Cheryl.
See your hands.
Officially, she's furniture. She comes with the apartment. She belongs to the tenant.
How many times you been in trouble with the police, Cheryl?
Never.
Can't hear you.
Never.
Captain Hatcher. First, he wanted this case solved.
Simonson. What do you say?
It was an assassination.
Now, he just wants it closed.
Who bought you?
High and hot, and they want this case closed permanently. Their way. Now, you sign this.
You sign it!
Thorne refuses to close the Simonson case.
Just do what you have to do. Where did you go with Simonson?
He took me to church.
Church?
Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. It has been 6 months since my last confession.
Carlton Heston, Edward G. Robinson, Chuck Connors, Lee Taylor Young, Brock Peters, Paula Kelly, and Joseph Cotton fight for survival and try to solve the most bizarre riddle ever to face mankind. The search for the secret of Soylent Green. You will find out why Soylent Green means life. You will find out why Soylent Green means death.
We've got to stop.
Soylent Green's a film from the 70s, and it's a representation of the debate about food today. Basically, the storyline is overpopulation in the world, is the prediction. It's only 10 years away, according to the film. It's overpopulation in the world. Everybody's living in urban centres. How do we feed ourselves? We harvest the ocean, so it's seaweed. We harvest the oceans, but the world then runs out of... and we turn the seaweed into tablets. Soylent Green, Soylent Amber, Soylent Red. The world starts the world starts to run out of Soylent Green. So what do? They turn people that are dying, they take their remains and turn them into food. And that's the whole story. But the whole story raises a number of issues that relate to the trends in society today about food. It's about who controls the food supply, food security, and the scramble for food, and where we're going. So if you take countries like China, you know, China as a country is expanding rapidly across the world to secure food supply. For example, it owns most of the banana crops in Madagascar. It owns most of the rice crop in Madagascar. It's buying farms across the world in order to feed its people. So, for example, in New Zealand, where I come from, there are big purchases and there's a big debate about Chinese corporations buying land and farms to then export dried milk to China. And there's a big debate across the world about that, about food security and about food supply. A very big issue. So it's about scramble for food and food supply. It's about food and culture, because in the film, the food's all about culture. Those that have money can afford real food, can afford fillet steak, and food as an elitist product in the terms of scramble. And the desire, if we look at the concepts of luxury today, food is very much up there in the terms of a luxury product and those that can afford it and those that can't. So food is a new luxury in society. Food experiences are very important. Big issue about food inflation and the price and about access to food. So food becomes scarcer as it is, and the world's going through global financial crisis. It's about the affordability, who can afford to eat and who can't afford to eat. Wealth distribution, big issue across most of the world in the terms of haves and have-nots in society. In today's society, the middle classes have been very much squeezed because of the global financial crisis. Well, there's a lot more richer people, so you get an increased bipolarization in many countries of the world. And if you look at the countries where you're seeing rapid growth from, in the terms of the Chinas and the Indias and the Russias, there's big diversifications in society there, big bipolars in the terms of wealth distribution. Urbanization. Migration to cities from the countryside, a big issue because you know, more than 50% of the world's population lives in cities today. The role of food supplements, science, and healthy lifestyle. Well, this is very mainstream. We take tablets. You know, we're in a society where you monitor what you eat and how you're eating it. And you have an application on your iPhone that tells you what your calorie count is. You take all of these supplements because you're concerned about obesity, you're concerned about your body. So the role of food science in society. And also, well, the film also touches on one other issue about, what's it called? If you are rich in society, a woman comes with the flat and she's called furniture. But it's a representation of the debate in the 1970s about equal rights for women in society. That's why it's representation in there. So what am I going to talk about for some of the issues are raised? I'm going to talk about this guy, gastrosexual, man's desire for food, man's desire to be a chef. And why is he doing it? He's trying to impress his lady. Okay, the gastrosexual. So basically, if you look at some of the, if you're trying to segment and look at market profiles, there's somebody that's 25 to 44 who's passionate about food, and it's all about pleasure, praise, and seduction. Because we all, this social media type of profile has exaggerated the role of the chef, and they've made him sexy. So, men's role in the kitchen. If you look at some of the trends in society, if you ask the question, who is the main cook in the house? It's predominantly woman. But if we look at different generations, if we look at different generations, we see men are taking a more important role in the terms of daily cooking within houses. If you look at the generation 18 to 24, the main cook in the house, it's become more of a shared activity, 20% between the male and the female. Still predominantly the female, but we've seen a big increase in men sharing the role of cooking, and also men being the main cook in the household as well, cooking the main meals. So again, it's a representation of how society's changed and what the roles are. The other thing about men and chefs, because we're living in a society where once upon a time, if you were female in the 1950s, you went straight from father to husband. At the age of 18, you got married at the age of 18, you didn't date. You just went out there and got married. Whereas today, the average female gets married at the age of 30. So you have about 11 to 12 partners before you find the right one and you have some choice. So it's all about the role of this society in the terms of Bridget Jones. And cookery classes are coming through. Cookery classes are becoming a new medium. And why, you know, if every city, for example, has salsa classes. Who here goes to tango or salsa? One. She's looking for a man. But we have that in society, and again, it's with cookery classes. Cookery classes are becoming mainstream. Why do we go there? It's men to find a female partner, or females to find a male partner. The other thing is, if you ask the question, why do young men want to cook? Why do people want to cook? If you ask the question, why do you want to cook? It's about seduction. It's about a new skill, or it's about impressing. And especially in that group, 18 to 44, okay? Compared to females. It's all about trying to impress. It's all about glory. It's all about seduction. If you're asking why do they want to cook? So it's about food for love in the terms of doing things. And how do men perceive cooking? Well, men perceive cooking as a skill or a hobby, not a chore. More men perceive cooking in the household as something to do, and it's a hobby, it's something I want to do, rather than a chore, compared to most classes. So if we look at that, it's considerably higher than females. And there's also something about food as a skill. Man today doesn't go out and hunt. You know, man the hunter, woman the homemaker. That roles have changed. So we have to, how do we replace that? Well, food today is about acquiring a skill. We want to learn to cook. It's a representation of masculinity in society. Males want to cook because it's a skill or a craft that they want, that they want to learn in the terms of doing something. So it's a craft, it's a skill. And it's, we also, males also cook because it's for glory, because men like praise. We want that female partner to say, yes, chef, in the terms of doing things. We want praise, we want glory, we want attention. So we're doing that and focusing on that in the terms of that type of question. And especially and that in that cohort, the gastrosexual. The other thing, it's about, if you look at the role of the chef and what they are, it's also a representation of identity and it's a representation of masculinity in society. You know, somebody very strong, masculine, taking the lead, and that's what Gordon Ramsay is. And that typical chef and that typical TV head chef role is an identification of that male icon. And to the opposite extreme, Jamie Pucker, he's very popular in the terms of somebody that's it's about no nonsense, I'm here with you. And why do men like cooking as well? Well, it's all about experimenting. We live in a society where we want new experiences and trying new things. We want to try things. We watch that TV program and say, I'll try that at home. I want to experiment and do different things. And we're experimenting because you as a consumer are traveling further and further away. You're going to the Indias, you're going to the Chinas, you're going to the Malaysias, you're going to the Italys, to these countries to taste the food. So the experience economy is extremely important to you, this diversity that you see in front of you. Because today in society, there's no such thing as the travel guide's called the Lonely Planet Guide, but the world, every country has a Lonely Planet Guide. Countries have food tourism products and food tourism guides, so extremely important. And the other thing that comes across very important is cooking is an expression of identity in the terms of creativity. We live in an economy, it's all about creativity today, and it's all about new experiences. So we want to test, we want to do things in the terms of that type of representation. But at the same time, why do we cook and what do we do? Why do we buy organic vegetables? Why do we buy organic vegetables or buy organic milk? Well, we don't buy organic milk because or organic vegetables, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, because they taste better, because we think the cows will be happier. That's why we do that. It's a perception thing in the terms of what it's all about. So food to some is a lie. Food is a representation of a lie. We go into a delicatessen and it's a representation of authenticity. It's something from the past. It's something we feel comfortable with because the past and history, it's about childhood and it's about representation of what we do. So authenticity is extremely important. Food has to tell a story. Food has a context and we have to link into it. So it's all about authentic seeking and that type of traveling. However, have you noticed this? Men cheat. Who here in the back row, gentlemen, how many girlfriends have you got on the go at the moment?
That you can tell me in public.
Or ladies, how many boyfriends have you got on the go at the moment? We're having a debate, okay? You know, we fall in love, get married, and we say it's forever, but we don't, we get divorced. So men, why do men cheat? Why do men cheat? We move on. Well, men also cheat at food. In the terms of cooking, we take in this lovely lady, want to romance her. You know, but some of us can't cook, so what can you do? Well, you can rent a chef nowadays. You can rent a chef. If you go to kitchenserving.com, you can rent a chef. We'll come into your home and do that cooking for you in the terms of that representation of what it's all about. So organizations are out there. Rent Chef is an online community designed to appeal to chefs. That's professional chef, that's you, who want to sell their skills. So you can rent a chef today. You can take it one stage further, and actually, we've had the microwave, but this is the Star Trek replicator. If you're a big Star Trek fan, this is the future of food.
Far more advanced to water, cold. I saw a similar device on a Tarkalian vessel. It was capable of replicating almost any inanimate object.
I wonder what else is on the menu. One pan-fried catfish.
See? Anything's possible in science. But it's people talking about reality, in the terms of what it's all about. We've had the microwave and how it's changed society in the terms of microwave meals and a convenient society and what it's all about. One of the big issues that's being debated at the moment in the terms of technology is what we call 3D printing. 3D printing is basically taking any type of basic concept and being able to replicate it in your home. And it's going to change the distribution channels of many products and many services across the world. Cornell University and their 3D research center has a 3D printer that can replicate food. Basically, the 3D printer at Cornell, basically you get the program of how to ice or decorate a cake. That's what it does. It decorates a cake. It's the new pastry chef version. And if you take that concept further, how could you replicate food in the terms of some of the theory that's going on in the terms of that? So if we look 20 years ahead, 3D printers that can create or co-create food in the terms of me being a male and continuing to lie. However, some things don't change. We like to cook, but the one thing that males can't do, we don't like washing up. That is still very much the role of the female within society, okay? We like to cook, and we've looked at chores, but very much we can't wash up behind. We just leave that mess, or we have a dishwasher. However, ladies, if you're looking for a man that does like to wash up, marry somebody from Denmark or Sweden, because they do wash up behind them. If you look at time use series or anything, anybody here from Sweden or Denmark? Ideal boyfriend, okay? Equality in the terms of what they're doing. But it's a society how certain things will change, but certain things won't. So that's just an idea of some of the overview of some of the trends in societies that relate to food and what they are. And they're happening today, and they will extrapolate going further in society. A copy of today's presentation will be available online from the FD website. Is that right? Okay, so let's talk about the concepts of hotels. What is a hotel? Well, a hotel is a space. It's a space. It's a physical space in the terms of what else. But if you look at some of the social sciences literature, we talk about the concept of liminality. Liminality is the concept of in between. What's science fiction and what's real? And today in society, it becomes very blurred because we live in a society that immerses ourselves, for example, into technology. We immerse ourselves into something. And tourism, to a certain extent, and hotels are that concept of fantasy. It's that concept of liminality. It's that negotiated space that we're unsure of and what's the purpose of what it's all about. And if you look at some of the works of Gareth Morgan at Cardiff University, he's written a lot about liminality and hotels and design and what the purpose is in the terms of where they are. So, The future of the hotel bedroom. By the year 2050, the hotel bedroom will be so technology advanced, it will be almost alive. Cutting edge technology will monitor tourists' energy levels, physical well-being, emotions, mood, to ensure a good night's sleep. Dream management education systems will help us learn new languages. The bed will have built-in memory to remember the guest's preferred settings and adaptive changes in the body. New technologies like claytronics will reconfigure into programmable matter, and hotel bedrooms are fundamentally a place between science fiction and reality of what they're all about. Because there's so much technology around today in the terms of what we do and how it's changing the concept. So I've got a question for you. So that's the question. So let's use this example of the future of hotels in Shanghai. Shanghai is a megacity. Shanghai is a place where everything that is modern usually happens as a first in that country. Shanghai was the first place to build a motor car, to have a motor car, to have trains, to have a cinema, and to have modern sewers. Shanghai's always been at the edge of what we call futurism, or technological science-based architecture of things that are modern. And Shanghai as a tourism destination has seen double-digit growth. Shanghai's destination has seen massive increases in international visitors. But at the same time, Shanghai has got major problems in the terms of urbanization. It's got lots of tourists. But from a policy and planning perspective is, how do you plan for the future? Because building more hotels means more competition for urban land. There's big issues about the quality of water in the country. And you've also got a consumer that's very modern and wants something that's within the realms of modernity or postmodernism in the terms of what you do. So it's about innovation and it's about new design. This is the new Intercontinental Hotel in Shanghai. It's built in a quarry. It's in a quarry. So it's about the use of space in a modern environment. And one of the key drivers is about sustainable architecture. We live in an environment where there's a scarcity of resources and energy prices are becoming more expensive. So how do you combine, how do you manage resources in a sustainable manner in a modern setting? How do you come up with something that's a product like that? So the Intercontinental Hotel in Shanghai is a representation of that. It's won a lot of the architectural awards that relate to that in terms of modern use of materials, energy, and development space. And we're living in a world of Star Trek. If you look at some of the concepts in the terms of design of glass from companies like Pilkington that are coming through, the hotel bedroom or the window pane becomes the TV. The window pane interacts because technology is embedded into that system. So it's this immersion of what it's all about. In terms of what? Some of the science areas that we've talked about, some of the science areas from Carnegie University, Mellon Carnegie University, talk about the concept of claytronics.
Imagine a technology that lets you create objects on the fly. A powerful new medium formed by billions of microscopic robots, each with computational abilities and sensors that enable interaction. Bring your ideas to the table and let it take shape, form, and color. Rendered dynamically out of captured 3D data, you can now touch it, feel it, mold it in your hands. A programmable matter that transforms your imagination into reality. Claytronics. Make it happen.
Claytronics is not the world of science fiction. If you look at some of the research centers that are looking at the topic and what they've developed, look at Carnegie University, look at Stanford University, look at CIT, California Institute of Technology, and the work that they're doing within that area. See where it comes in the next 15 years in terms of the future. The other thing that's very important is space. If you look at Shanghai, it's about the competition for space. So space is expensive in urban centers. So the concept of the Citizen M Hotel in Amsterdam, Glasgow, going to New York and Moscow, it's all about space. Fundamentally, it's about they're pods or the containers that are built together. It's a container that comes in the terms of structures, and it's just built on top of each other, built on top of each other. When you ask consumers what do they want in a room, it's all about a big bed and big TV screens. So to condense space, they fundamentally took the bathroom out of the bedroom as a separate entity. The bathroom and the toilet is a space within the room. It's not a separate room. Okay, that's what they did in the terms of concept design, because space is scarce, and combining that with the trend of modernity. We also look at technology of other things and what we can do. We've already got today nanotechnologies and self-cleaning windows in the terms that we can design bathrooms to minimize cleaning spaces, for example, in the terms of what you can do and how you can do it. We've had a go at robotics, and we've had a go at robots to Hoover, but they're not that successful. Trying to model complexity and human decision-making is extremely hard, and robotic Hoovers are very cumbersome if anybody's ever had one, but we'll get there. So I'm going to ask you, what is the primary activity of a hotel bedroom? What's the primary activity of a hotel bedroom? Sleeping? Rest. Something else beginning with S came out of the front row. Okay. Well, the primary example of a hotel bedroom, it is. It's all about that. And if you look at some Valoneers and Virtuitis papers in the Annals of Tourism last year, they talk about the role of a hotel bedroom is about rest, recover, and getting away from the stress and demands of everyday life. So the fundamental question about the hotel bedroom and its concept, it's about rest. It's about somewhere to sleep. And that's the fundamental concept of what a hotel is. That's the primary activity of what it's all about. And sometimes we forget that. So if we look at some of the things how do we improve that? Well, today we can, if you look at the hotel bedroom and the hotel concepts and some of the innovations that are around there, health is extremely important in society. And today you can buy pajamas or nighties or whatever you wear in the bedroom, because some of us don't wear anything at all, that monitor your health in the terms of what it's all about. You can build in technologies that monitor your well-being and how you're sleeping and what you're doing in the terms of going through. So you can build in these technologies into the pillowcases. You can build in these technologies into the bedspreads. You can have embedded technologies into the fabrics of your hotel to monitor health systems, because health is extremely important to that consumer in the terms of what's driving them. Looking into the far future, we can also, people have been talking about, there's a paper published 2 years ago in the journal Nature, which is the world's leading science Nature, which is about the development of recording devices for your dreams. So when you're asleep, when you're snoozing away and dreaming of something, we can then turn it into a film or a DVD in the terms of doing some of the examples. If you want to know more about the topic, just Google the guy called Ian Pearson, who's a futurist based in Switzerland, and he's done some work with a company called Travelodge on this concept about what will the future hotel look like. And there's some wacky science there, but that wacky science is based upon science and stuff that's happening in the laboratory today about how you do that. This is another concept. Imagine going into the hotel bathroom, and have you seen the film Sleeping Beauty? And they have that, say, mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all? Well, that's a reality. You can do that. This is a researcher at MIT and the concept he's talking about.
My name is Ainsar Poe. I'm a PhD candidate at Harvard MIT Division of Health Sciences Technology, and I work at the Media Lab. We have developed a new technology that enables remote, non-contact measurements of vital signs such as heart rate and respiration rate using a basic digital camera like a webcam. This technology provides a very simple and convenient method for keeping track of your health. For example, using this technology, we have built a medical mirror that can measure your heart rate. This is a two-way mirror, and there's a computer monitor with a built-in camera behind it. So when you stand in front of the mirror, the camera detects your face and starts to track it over time. And the video information is then processed to compute your vital signs, which is displayed back to you on the mirror. So you can imagine every day when you look into the mirror, not only do you see your physical appearance, You also get a snapshot of your health or physiological information. And this data can also be transferred through the internet to your healthcare providers. And when you start to keep track of these health indicators over a longer duration of time, such as days or weeks, you can learn about the patterns and trends in the data and spot any deviations.
Okay, so mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all? So staying in the hotel, and again, checking your health and what you are and how you're doing it. Basically, I've just covered a number of trends there that are happening in society. And when you're looking at future predictions, you usually get it wrong. So everything that I've said today is probably going to be wrong, because it's extremely difficult to do that, because in the terms, I've just taken a number of trends that we've got in society there and talked about some of the predictions and where they're going. If you want to understand more, it's all about scenarios and scenario planning, which is the work of FD here. Because many people have said in the past, well, everything that's been invented has been invented. And that was Charles Duhigg in 1872. And Thomas Watson of IBM said in 1946, I think there is a world market for about 5 computers. Okay, so predictions is a very dodgy science from a social science perspective. And if you want to know what the rest of the world is looking at and you want to know more trends, buy the book. I need the royalties. I think that books, both of these books are available in the library. And my website's tomorrowstourism.com, tomorrowstourist.com, and there's lots of free articles on there. It also links into to some of the books I'm writing at the moment. The presentation on the gastro chef is going to be a chapter in my forthcoming book next year about the future of food tourism. So I haven't written that yet. This is just the initial thoughts. Anyway, that's it. If you want to know more, contact me by FD or speak to Albert. Thank you. Great, from the door.